To add the physical ducts, I will use the Systems tab on the ribbon and the Duct tool. Once I've picked the tool, I look to the right of the ribbon and choose any of the placement tools that I wish to use, including the ability to change the justification, which is by default the center of the duct, or inherit elevation and size of existing ducts. Before I go to the options bar, I want to use the type selector to change the type of duct that I am creating, verifying if I'm creating oval, rectangular, or round duct. Once I set that, I look to the options bar and verify that I'm adding in the correct size. I do have the ability to offset, and this offset is from the default elevation of the view that I'm in. In this case, I'm in a first floor, so these offsets are from the first floor level. You can either choose the pit drop-down or you can type in a value. If you type in a value, that value is stored and you can later choose it again. In this case, I know that the ductwork is running at that value, so I can start drawing in my ductwork. To draw the ductwork is simply a matter of picking points. And you can see that Revit is automatically registering these values as I move near other ducts. As I turn corners, Revit will automatically provide the elbows or corners as needed. As I'm transitioning to a vertical duct, I do want to move to the options bar and lock the elevation down. That way, when I pick this duct, it doesn't try and pick the endpoint, which may be below or above. So by locking the elevation, it automatically keeps this as one elevation rather than trying to connect to the top or the bottom of the duct that's in this chase. I also can choose to inherit size and elevations from existing ducts. So if I choose to inherit size and elevation, I can pick the duct, and as I pick endpoints in the connectors, Revit will automatically add both the transitions as well as the corner conditions. Here, I see that Revit has given me a warning. These types of warnings, which are a little yellow, are ignorable warnings, meaning that if you do anything else, they will disappear. You can get the list of warnings later, but what I'd like to do is I'd like to take care of these as they happen. So here, Revit has placed a fitting on top of another transition, or a transition on top of another transition. I will just manually go delete that transition so I don't have to correct that later. It's always a good idea to take care of these as they happen. There are another couple of items I should mention, talking about ducts. One is the duct placeholder. If you're in schematic design or early design, you might want to use the duct placeholder. It also has an associated diameter, offset, and shape with it. However, when I draw it, it just simply creates a single line element. So while you can see the other ducts have the two-line representation, the placeholder just is a single-line representation. If I want to convert it to ducts later, I can select it, and on the ribbon, choose Convert Placeholder, and it will transition itself into the type of duct that it was assigned when I created the placeholder. The other aspect of this is to select a duct, I can hover over one duct, strike the Tab key to select the entire duct branch. So I'm changing elevations. I can create the duct and have it an offset. If I need to go up or down, I just simply change the offset on the options bar as I'm adding the duct. I don't need to get out of the command and add another piece of duct. And Revit will provide the transitions needed to make that adjustment. If you want to select just a portion of duct, you can select a piece of duct, move to another location in that duct run, tab once, and it will select only that portion of duct. If I want to manually add in flex ducts, I can use the flex duct tool and verify that the system type is correct, and hover my cursor over the end of a duct, making sure that I'm hitting the connection point. Once I pick the connection point on the duct, I can pick the connection point on the terminal, and the flex duct is automatically created in three dimensions as well as in the plan view. While Revit gives you automatic placement of ducts, as well as automatic sizing, I find sometimes manually placing the ducts just as easy as using the automatic placement routines.